Hello and welcome to the first vlog in this PHP web framework series. So what is this PHP web framework? It's actually been on GitHub for a while. It's a open source framework that we are developing to just speed up the process of creating websites. We just want to, first of all, I want to say it's actually built on top of a bunch of code that I followed tutorials on PHP Academy, or actually what's called Code Course now. It's a YouTube channel. Check the chance out if you're watching this series, probably already know about them. If you don't, check them out. There'll be a link in the description with a great watch some of their video. I watched a load of the Alex's videos, it's mainly him, over the years. But this particular sort of login, like object oriented programming series that I followed, I did that. It was a good structure, and I've just built it on top of that. And the aim with the PHP web framework is to provide features that are very common amongst websites, and but they're difficult or they're just laborious tasks to implement. Best way to show you, like I said, it's all open source. There'll be a link in the description. I've just done it for me. I've also got this Trello board of stuff that I want to add that's in progress, upload to GitHub. That was just like the sort of, it had been a while since I'd uploaded it, so I just wanted to make sure I had it uploaded. So add to sonar testing domain, that's something more for me than anything else. I don't know how much we're gonna do of these in this particular video. This is just an intro just to show you what's happening, because unlike my other vlog series, which is creating a modern OpenGL game engine, I've already spent months of work on this. So I just thought it'd be good to share it, because it's shared anyway via GitHub. So it's not like we've just recently started sharing. I was sharing it from day one. So it's just nobody really knows about it. So it's be a good way to publicize it. Plus also, well, you get the community involved. So let's go to the framework. I'll log out, for example. It's got a built-in login and register system. It's got built-in Google and Facebook login. It's uses hybrid auth, which is an open source framework library, and it has a bunch of the stuff like Twitter, Yahoo. Like, yeah, it's got loads of stuff in there for social logins. Google and Facebook are the only ones we've implemented at the moment. I did briefly implement Twitter, but Twitter was annoying because you couldn't get the email address for security reasons. Google and Facebook you can, because the way we've done it is when the user logs in using, say, a social login, it adds it to the Facebook or Google users page. It also adds that to the users page as well, so you'll add an ID, which is auto-incremented. You won't add a username, you won't add a password, you add the email address, you'll create a salt when it's joined. Usually if you just register normally, it won't activate it, but because you're doing it via your own some sort of SSO, it will set activated to 1. So what will happen is every time you try and log in using that, if you haven't set username and password, you'll come up first saying, one more step left, can you enter your username and password? This isn't actually working at the moment in my current setup, and the reason is it's simple, is because one, I've just removed the ID and secret keys, and the reason is because I was actually developing this on a different machine before, and what happened is I'm developing it on, well, this machine now, and on that machine it was slightly set up differently, so the authorized URLs for the social logins were slightly different. Haven't updated them, so I just removed the functionality. But again, trust me, it works. But for the login, that works fine. That password 8, just ignore that. You'll see why it says that, but that's just something that I put in there. Registration works fine. It's got validation built in, which is fantastic. So let me show you some of that stuff. Also, what I want to show you, you don't really have a concept of like index, for example. This is all that's in index. You will never be touched. Realistically, you probably wouldn't be touching the index file. You'll get header, which is from the elements, so it's universal across all the different pages. And here, so it's like so much shit to show you, but there's a bunch of stuff. So we have configuration. So if you go to core configs, meta config, so you can put keywords and whatnot. It's just an easy place to go to instead of going to the header, and it just adds them appropriately. If you want to add, for example, library files, if you go to like libs to include the built-in libraries using CDN, so all I would need to do is just to change this to a 1, save that, refresh. As you can see, styling slightly changed, and that's because the w3.css framework is now implemented. It's that simple. And if I go to, for example, into the built-in libs file, this is where all the files are, or the locations, and you'll include these appropriately. These just stand for underscore underscore JavaScript underscore built-in libraries, libs, built-in. Is this being called build libs? Yeah, that's fine for now. It doesn't really matter. And in the init, this is where like pretty much all of it's just getting started, like session starting. If you have your database config, website config set, like the debug mode set to true or false, what you'll do is set error reporting to true or false as well. And what the debug mode does is when it tries to load a JavaScript or a, so these are, I'm looking at this and okay, that's fine. My bad, yeah. Files to include. Yeah, fine. Files to include. So, for example, to include a CSS file in CSS, index.css, you just put the path. I mean, you just put the name of the file, index, and then you put a version. That is it. That is literally it. But if you go to the header, if you don't have, what's it called, debug, if you have debug enabled, what you'll do is when it includes it, it will append the version, which will actually be, as you can see, the time if it doesn't have, if debug is enabled. So it's always giving a fresh copy. The same case for the footer as well. I think there's something that I wanted to sort out, because we've got the files to include, and this is the internal file. Then in libs to include, you can add libs to include in terms of, you know, content delivery networks, and this is the way you would include them. But you can also do it for local libs as well. So I'm just trying to think, should I, because this essentially came before this bit of code, but what I'm thinking is, if you want a bit more flexibility, so to be able to set a specific, you know, folder, or if you want to add some sort of other, you know, what's it called, is it parameters or arguments, what are they called, element properties, element attribute, if you want to change some other attribute in link or whatever it is, they're actually, I'm going to leave this, so it provides you with a bit more flexibility. But we've got a bunch of configs, so if I were to go to, like, yeah, the DB config, you can set in there where database is enabled, the database, you just go into here and change it, and it gets updated wherever it needs to be used. There's a bunch of classes here, so like the easy to use database class, and you use these PDOs, but security built in, reasonable amount of security. It's got a good email system, which is built on top of the PHP mailer, and it's got templating for that as well. So if we go down, templates, email, activation email template, at the moment in here all we got is a simple URL, but you can modify these accordingly and pass in parameters. It's a great way of doing stuff. It's got like a sitemap as well. It's got robots.txt, it's got obviously some stuff you will need to modify, but it's got a whole heap of stuff that you would generally be creating. So it's got validation stuff, user login, which again is integrated with the social logins. It's got stuff for redirection, recapture, for example. So we got the Google recapture built in, which is fantastic. All you would have to actually to use that, all you would have to do is go to core configs, core configs, then go to security. I'm not going to go on there because it's got a secret key on there, but that's all you need to do is go and change the IDs and then you'll be all good to go. Error handling, cookie, it's got a whole heap of stuff. It's got stuff for import, stuff to help prevent cross-site forgery, some other tasks which really haven't been categorized yet. So change website title. This is one that I'm sure that people watching or friend people I know that are, let's say, coders, will be like, why have you got this method to echo out some JavaScript? And the reason is, if I go to app, it sort of uses a MVC pattern, but it's not very strict on it. The reason is, I find a lot of people these days, it happens all the time, they jump on a certain programming paradigm, be it MVC, be it MVP, wherever some of the other ones are. And one, they don't know how to properly implement them. And two, they just implement them because they think that's what needs to be done. Then in a few years, they'll jump on another paradigm. And one thing I loved about MVC, and that was routing, which was this here, where you can do forward slash public is where your user would go to. That's what they would access. So it's from there they would access it. Instead of doing index.php, you don't do that anymore. You can't do that anymore. You do forward slash, then you're sort of, it's grouped into, where are we going? Views. It's grouped into sort of like sections. So you would have home, which has add user details, whatnot, all this stuff. Then in extra, I think this is a cool thing as well, that in here, and it's got stuff, it's got a basic privacy policy, which is cool. And what it uses is a website title, but again, that's in the config for the website. You don't need to access these files. You just go to it for the, you know, the support email. You don't need to access it. It's all within core, configs, website, it's all in here. You just change the contact email address, change the title, obviously a version, you just increase the version, change contact name. Let's go back to policy, and it gets all updated here, which is fantastic. And then we also have a built-in change log as well. So if I go to change log, should be extra, /change log, and this is what happens when you try and access one that doesn't exist. It goes to the default one for that particular page. It's got some, yeah, so release notes, very important stuff, you use them all the time. I mean, a lot of websites have them. We've tried to create an easy, consistent way of doing them. So if, for example, you go to change log, all you do at the top is have an array, and each array within that array is essentially a particular log, I mean a particular version, and you set the version code, you set the version number, again should just usually be a simple integer digit, you set a date, you set the different arrays, so you can have new, updated, fixed and removed, and you merely add something new in there. This is all you have to do, and then all of this loops through it and update, like just displays it. And this just shows the user, the front end user, what each part of it means. So if I save it, refresh, as you can see, it's updated it and it's added these new features apparently that were in version 2, 6th of October 2018, so in 2 years, will becoming a new feature. But it's just an easy way of showcasing, like doing this. Eventually might put this into some sort of database and have some sort of, we don't have concept of admins at the moment, but that will be a feature coming down the road. For now, this is just more than suffices. And if, for example, you didn't have any new features, you'd have to put it there. You do that and it just doesn't display the new section. It's as simple as that. We wanted to keep it simple. You don't have to go down and change anything. God damn it. Brackets sometimes does mess up for me. Let's put this here.
Okay, that's all good. And yeah, it's that simple. Or you would like, if you wanted to style this, you literally need to style this part here, which most of that is just PHP loops. So you out of like this part of it, you need to just style this one line. If you just style these, I don't know, 20 odd lines of HTML, you'll have a good looking, potentially responsive website. And to add more chain logs, you would just do this. It's very simple stuff. And again, the header and the footer is attached to this, and I'll demonstrate that by going to header. So I put save, refresh. As you can see, it's there. It's in the policy. It's on the home page. It is literally everywhere now. This is a great way of just keeping the header and footer consistent. The database is a singleton, you can access it anywhere. It's under the sonar namespace. And okay, we got like a favicon sort of feature built in, where if you just go to this link, generate favicons, and all you have to do then is go to public images, upload your favicons to this folder here, and that's it. And this bit of code will do the rest. You don't have to code anything else in. Again, these are basic features that are used over and over and over again, and we're trying to simplify it. And the way you do paths, because the way we've done our website is a little different. Anytime you want to do a local path, you have to do is slightly different. You have to do, it depends on what you're doing. So if you're getting like the path to a file, you do sonar backslash, because that's the namespace, miscellaneous :: prepend root, and then you simply put where you would want to put it. And this prepend root would essentially prepend whatever your root is, because you could have just the root. It could be something like website.com/public, then index.php, or it could be website.com/something/something2/millenniumfalcon/water/public, and this will sort all of that out. Right? It's all dynamic, and yeah, you don't have to do anything else. So you just put that, then the file, like the path of the image, and that will refer to this right here. Something else I want to show you as well. What's the other thing? So we show you the prepend root. Oh yeah, to get like a path to a particular view, yeah, and the views are what you see. What you need to do, actually, let me show you something else. This is like so much to show you. If I go to the controllers, this is what handles where your particular website goes to. So if it accesses index, goes to home/index. If you go to change password, and that means home/change password, aka the name of the file, which would be home here, then /login. So you would go to home class, then login, and that says go to the home folder within views and go to the login file. That's essentially the way it works. Extra, there you go. And yeah, it's that simple. Okay, so you can also pass in variables, which we do for the activate and the reset password stuff. We pass in the username and some sort of activation and reset code. Very simple stuff. It passes it into the model like so, and these are usable within the code. This is stuff, again, just go through and have a look. Just a couple of things I want to show you. So if I go to index.php, to get a path to a particular sort of view, you do sonar:path:2, then you put home/logout. That is it. And if we go to path class, so we can show you, to miscellaneous prepend root, and it gets the root location. So yeah, what else is there? Oh yeah, if we go back to sort of, let's say, the login page, I was talking about the change website title. Instead of having to every single time put this JavaScript code, trying to remember what it is, and to change the document title for every single page, for different pages, I should say, you just you literally do for, you just do miscellaneous, change website title, and then you put the website title, simple as that. So to create a user, this is what you do, just checking logged in. So we've essentially got the index, the login, logout, register, and all these other pages created, and all you would do is if you scroll down, you just style this. For the most part, you probably won't need to touch much of this. You may want to change it depending on what sort of data you are storing, let's say in the users table. And if you do change that, you obviously you'll need to update the code. You might be changing what sort of validation you're doing. So if you go to register, the validation is very simple. You create a validate class, then you do validate check. You put what you want to check. So this is the what has been submitted via a form. At the moment, we've only got sort of form validation. What we really should add in is some sort of non-form validation. So you can just pass in a sort of a variable, some data, but you can do the same sort of validation. That's something we'll add to the Trello board. But yeah, so you put username, and then you put the sort of validation you want. It needs to be required. It needs to have a minimum of 2 characters. Maximum of 32 characters. It needs to be unique within the users table. It needs to be numeric. Nope. It needs to be an email. Nope. And what this means is it cannot be numeric. It cannot be an email. So if it is an email type or it is a number only, this does not pass validation. And all you do is this. And this array passes the names of like the fields, essentially, not the ID but the names, and this is what is printed out. Remember, you know, this, I click login, this password 8, that is in here, password 8. This is what the user sees. So if I go to register, click register, username is required. So it is essentially what we put here. So if this was a different type of field, put that, refresh, register, says username, blah, blah, blah is required. And if, for example, I were to put just the number 3, register, username, must be a minimum of 2 characters, must not be a number. So it's failed twice and it will not let me proceed until all of these things are fixed. Then that's built in. You just need to go down here and the looping is over here in terms of the echoing, the flush, like a flash based system. So you in your session, you just flash something and it just says you've been registered. So when you go to, let's say, the home page, which will be the index, you can check for a flash of it in a particular section and just echo out that. You can style it accordingly. So if we go back to register, very, very simple stuff. So send it an email, it's all here. We'll be covering more and more of this as we go on. We've got hashing stuff built in, just common methods. What else have we got here? Like I said, we need to abstract this out realistic. Not abstract here, if I go to the validate PHP file. So we've got, what we got is this check method. We've got a constructor, but we've also got a check method, and this check method or simply checks stuff. But it is based on the fact that it's either post or get data, which it might not be. It may be, what was I gonna say, it may just be variables, like data that you're passing in. So this needs to be abstracted in some form. So I'll put that onto this. If I put abstract validation so it can be used for variables and other data. I think that's going to be quite an important task. So what I'm going to do, I should be, I'm going to put a red label for that. Member, I'm going to assign it to myself. And what I'm gonna do is whack that at that the top. This is stuff that we actually, this is now skipped actually. Skipped. This was that bunch of library stuff that we had, but we've just decided for now we're gonna leave it. So to go back, yeah, we need to abstract that. I'll probably do that in the next video, because at the moment I'm just showing you around the stuff like library. So we got hybrid auth, which is for social logins, and we'll show you the sort of like social logins that you can implement with a bit of extra effort, just probably a few hours worth of work. 500 pixels, Bitbucket, DigitalOcean, Drupal, Dropbox, Drupal OAuth. What else we got? Instagram, MailChimp. Just take a look at some of the stuff that you can implement. And that's the additional providers. There are more providers as well. So if we go to hybrid auth, hybrid providers, and I was. Weird. Refresh file tree. Okay, so yeah, these are sort of like core providers, but again, you can just use the additional providers if you want more. Got PHP Mailer, which is a good emailing service. Error the 404 stuff. I think that's been disabled for now. Using the internal stuff. What else we got? It's time. Again, this is one of those ones that I know a lot of people may argue, why do we need this? But it's very common to convert time to not only a readable format, but to a local time. That's what we're doing. Because if, for example, you have a epoch time, so where is that? Have we got an example here? We don't actually have one here. I know we've got one in the database, so let me go into here like this. This is the time of this, like me getting the time on the server. So if, for example, we have a social network and I post something and it's 5 p.m. here, and where you are it's 2 p.m. obviously where I am it should show that it's being posted at 5 p.m. where you are it shouldn't be shown as 5 p.m. because what if by the time you check it's only 2:30? What it's saying is being posted in the future. It should actually modify, it should be changed for the location, and you need JavaScript for that, because JavaScript is client side. So the time that you use this, or the time in system, is also client side, and instead of having to change the code, like do this all the time and trying to remember stuff, all you do is call our method. And it just echoes out some JavaScript, so you can get a full date, you can get a full time, which this shows what each one of those does. You can convert to seconds if you want to, and you just put the amount and then the type as well. So if it's minutes, you'll convert it to blah blah blah. You can also convert it to milliseconds. And this add zero is a internal method. So yeah, there's just a whole heap of stuff built in. I recommend you dig around on it, and we'll be just adding more features. So let's see what we got. The abstraction of the validation, which we talked about. Again, this is just something for me internally. A commenting system and a forum. Once we have done the commenting system and a forum, at the moment it's on like version 0.5.0. Once we've done the commenting system and the forum, what will happen is I will version it as version 1.0.0 alpha, and that's the sort of, I would say, I'm using it now in websites. It has been tested, it's just limited in features. I just want the forum and the commenting system, and they could be like a simple all-rounded framework then. So for the forum and framework, I actually posted a question on GitHub to ask for some help. I was thinking, how should I do in terms of how many levels should you have, because some forums, if you, let's say, ask a question, somebody can reply to it, and somebody can respond to that response. But how many times should you allow that? And somebody kindly replied, and they had a fantastic idea. They said that should be up to the developer. And they actually gave a way to do that. They said what the developer should have is some sort of either constructor or some sort of setting which says you want 5 levels, for example. And what it does is when you post something, if it has a parent, either a post or response, it puts that in some sort of like parent ID column, and it also has a sort of level column which says how many levels it's already into it. And then what that does is allow you to check when you try and on the front end post or have a button that says reply to, if the check says this is the last level that's allowed by the developer, do not show this on the front end, it will not show it on the front end, and likewise it won't allow it on the back end. It's stuff that you'll understand when we start explaining it. And the forum and the commenting system. So the commenting system is going to go hand in hand with the forum. The forum is going to be more just like a collection of commenting systems. Because the commenting system, you'll see that within sort of non-forum pages. And we want to be able to separate that from the forum. So we'll have the commenting system initially, which will be the vast majority of it. Then there'll be like a container, which will be forum, which will have like an extra layer, which will be essentially like the section, like categories and questions, that sort of stuff. And then each one will just implement a commenting system. Remove all closing PHP tags. So if I go to a file input, I've read that you should, it's not recommended to have closing PHP tags, because if, let's say, you have white space at the end and you include this file, it will pick that up as HTML, so it's best not to have it at all. So we'll do that. Integrate sentry.io. I don't know if you've seen this, but it's fantastic. And they have a free model, which is what I loved about it. Sentry, a great way of reporting errors. So let's just go to the docs. Because you always want to know if your website's going okay, is everything all good. And a great way, you can use something, you can either create your own or use something like Sentry. Once you've integrated it, which will add all of, again, we'll be adding this as an external library, and you have an option to activate it or not. Once you've done this, if you go to like the API reference, I want to actually show you I want to get to the code. So usage. So yeah, what you would do, you can either report an exception. So once you've initialize your Sentry client, you can do capture exception. So if you've got an actual exception, you can post that, or you can just capture a message, which is essentially just a general error, so a non-exceptional exception object. And this is great. So if, for example, go into the login view, log in here, if you do try and do something, actually should do register instead. Yeah, here's the great thing. So if you scroll down, it says error creating account, and this, it will only go into here if, for example, if for some reason the email was not successfully sent. So obviously we've just said error create an account, that's what the user would see, but you might actually capture some sort of message, send it to Sentry, and if, let's say, you keep getting messages saying creating an account is failing at the email, say, you know that you need to be checking that shit out. So I think that's not going to be a cool thing. So obviously we can capture the exception here, and yeah, it's just a great way of just capturing messages. And I think you could do it just sort of like the more methods as well, check them out. And it's not just for PHP, there's a bunch of
languages, but we're only concerning ourselves with PHP. But you could, I guess, also use it for non-error-based stuff. I know that's essentially what it's used for, but you could use it for anything, really, if you just wanted general message. So every time a user does something, you could have Sentry. You'll probably want to use Google Analytics for that. Actually, really should implement Google Analytics, but I think there was a reason why I wasn't implementing Google Analytics, because it was almost like, because it was so, I want to say easy, but that sort of code will probably change because you just get a snippet. So, but what I am going to do is, you'll see this a lot in stuff like Shopify, for example, in their like backend, the backend like admin page, you'll have a section, like a box that says, put all JavaScript that you want to be run at the end of the body or at the start of the body. I think if we had something like that, so in here, we would just have some code that gets some code from some file, you know, like we've got these, but we just have two files. One will be for the end of the JavaScript, one will be for the end of the body tag, one will be for the start of the body tag, and just runs that particular code. Instead of you having to go into the header and footer, this is a great way of just separating it, and that would be element. Again, should that be? I think that should be within elements, and I should put that within sub. I'm gonna add that as a task. Run code files for the start and end the body. Remove all closing tags. Okay, let's assign this to myself. This is sort of like a yellow task. Integrate Sentry. Method for easily loading fonts using a PHP method. So yeah, what I want to do with this, because when you create, including your own font, you'll do font family, and for that you would do like at font family, assuming non-Egyptian braces, you'll do curly braces, and on the next line you would do the location, and then you would do the font family name that you want to be able to refer to it, and then closing braces, that's five lines. And I want to simplify that, so you just have a file, which is sort of like font configuration, and in there you have some sort of PHP array, and in there you simply have, we've essentially already got something similar, yeah, you would have something like this, and all you would do is duplicate this every single time, you would put the location, and then you put the actual font family name. So I think that's probably gonna be best if I put this within the core file. So this will be files to include, I think we're just creating a one saying fonts to include, and we'll have a folder called fonts, and this is where you'll place it. Again, it's just gonna be to help simplify as much as possible after. On a miscellaneous method that allows you to generate paragraphs, it's great for testing sometimes, instead of you having to do a bunch of text like random key presses or trying to get some sort of random paragraph off the internet. I might get some sort of random paragraph generator API potentially, but I'm gonna do lorem ipsum initially, which is I think a piece of Latin text, and lorem ipsum stands for pain itself. So integrate API potentially, versioning for images, so yes, what it is, as we got versioning for files like CSS and JavaScript,
I want versioning for images, because it's I'm still the jury's still out on that, whether I should have that, you know, or not.
Documentation, this just needs to be created. As you can see, there's already a lot of code here, a lot of features. It's going to keep growing. Need documentation. Support database scheme with alpha, and this is essentially what this will be is. In our database, we can export the structure of our database. So when you put this on your server, local or online, you just go to your sort of SQL, MySQL sort of page, wherever that's my PHP, my admin or something else. You import this particular thingamajiggy, this database schema, and your database is all set up. Database backup tool for admin, so we want sort of, so some sort of page that allows you to back up your database via a click, or you can select what databases you want to back up. It would be a, like a very useful tool, but we can't be doing that before we have some sort of admin system. Realistically, on a built-in W3 validator, I haven't quite don't know how to do that yet, but it's on the list. I want to create tests, and again, I think it would be good to accompany the documentation. Testing API and functionality. So this is the tests are essentially examples of different scenarios. Testing API functionality is to be able to, you know, implement testing into your application. Some sort of wireframing system. Again, some of this isn't quite there yet in terms of ideas. It's just put there. Theme system, integrate header and footer. I want some sort of theme system. Integrate header and footer. I'm not too sure what I was thinking at the time, because some of these tasks, even though this Trello board was only recently created, as you can see, yeah, a few days ago, these tasks were initially on some other like project management platform, and we moved it from there, but they've been on there for ages. I want single sign-on, some sort of auth-based system, because I want to be able to have, if you want to create a website and that has, or that is the single sign-on based system, and then can implement other websites using that single database, that single login system. I want to add that, some sort of notification system, and an install setup file, so you can just have this file, you open it, sort of like the WordPress install file, and it's in, it creates the database tables, it does everything that it needs to do. And yeah, we've got another bunch of stuff that we want on there and that we will add, but for now this was just a quick overview of where we're at with the framework, what we're doing, and our intentions. Like I said, the source code is on GitHub. There'll be a link in the description for that source code. Feel free to check it out, contribute, make any suggestions, anything you want. That will really be appreciated. And yeah, together we're going to create the best and easiest sort of Laravel competitor killer ever. And it's gonna be free, obviously, like Laravel, but it's gonna be even better. So thank you for watching. If you like the video, please give it a thumbs up, hit that subscribe button, and leave us a comment. And as usual, thank you for watching, and I hope you have a great day. Where am I? I sort of ended that. It's still there. It's sort of like the post-credit scene that you see in all the Marvel movies. I sort of ended that as if it was a video tutorial. The video tutorial would stop, edit the start and the end, and so you wouldn't see the sort of that sort of build up and then the outro. But now you'll see me talk about how I messed up there. But okay, yeah, bye bye, and I will see you tomorrow.